the last session of the day. The text will be presented by Professor Johannes Palisch, who studied at the Freie Universität Berlin and is now professor for Byzantine studies at the Johannes Gutenberg Universität Mainz, Germany. He published a monograph on the history of the Greek Orthodox Patriarchate of Jerusalem in the Crusader period. He's co-editor of Christian-Muslim Relations, a historical biography, and has published numerous articles on the situation of Oriental Christians under Muslim rule in the Middle Ages and their relations between Byzantium and the Islamic world. He was awarded fellowships of the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, the Institute for Advanced Studies of the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, the Dumbarton Oaks Research Library and Collections, Washington DC, and the Anne-Marie Schimmel College at the University of Bonn. He is member of the board of the Leibniz Science Campus Mainz, Byzantium between Orient and Occident. He recently published the Arabic translation of a Byzantium legal code, the Poshir Nomos.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Today I would like to present you three different texts about conversion from Christianity to Islam. All of these texts originate from a Chalcedonian, so to speak, Greek Orthodox, or rather Byzantine and Melkite milieu. First, a few remarks about the Melkites. The Melkites are generally spoken autochthonous, originally Syriac or Aramaic, that increasingly Arabic-speaking members of the Byzantine Imperial Church in Syria and Egypt. Accordingly, they followed the Theophysite doctrine of the Council of Chalcedon. So in the 5th and 6th centuries, they cannot be designated as an independent religious community. After the Muslim conquest of Syria and Egypt in the 7th century, however, the Melkites' relationship to Byzantium seems to have been quite ambivalent. The Byzantine Imperial Church regarded them certainly still as members of this Byzantine Church, despite the fact that the ways of communication between Constantinople and Syria and Egypt had been very restricted at these times. One has to keep in mind that the Byzantine emperors saw themselves always as Roman emperors. Thus, the claim to all the lands that have been part of the Roman Empire was never abandoned, notwithstanding all the fundamental changes and territorial losses the Byzantine Empire suffered in the course of its history. According to the Byzantine doctrine, Syria and Egypt were just temporarily lost provinces. Their reconquest would have been legitimate and was actually pursued as soon as Byzantium had the means to do so. In this sense, it was one of the duties of the Byzantine emperor to protect the rights of the Orthodox Chalcedonian Christians in the Orient. However, if the Melkites indeed belonged also after the Muslim conquests to the Byzantine Church is disputed. The example of Jerusalem illustrates how difficult it was to maintain the official channels of communication with Byzantium. As a consequence of the surrender of Jerusalem to the Muslims in 638 AD and after the death of the Greek patriarch Sophronius I in the same year, the Church of Jerusalem was isolated from the Byzantine Church. The restoration of the Patriarchate a few years later was thus initiated by the local Chalcedonian community without recurrence to Constantinople. Under the Islamic conquest, until the Islamic conquest, the mother tongue of the majority of the Melkites would have been Aramaic. Following the establishment of the Caliphate and linguistic Arabization of the Melkites becomes evident, and at least from the end of the 8th century onwards, a specific Melkite literature in Arabic developed. Arabic consequently replaced Aramaic not only as a vernacular, but also as a language of church literature. With regard to content, these Christian Arabic texts were mostly translations of the Bible, sermons, and hagiography, which were meant for a broad audience. Liturgy was a noteworthy exception. Actually, Aramaic maintained its position as liturgical language against the dominant trend of Arabization into the 13th century and further on. The reason for the exceptional position of liturgy may be found in the idea that the Malachites thought of the language used for prayers, liturgy, and for communication with God to be, in a sense, as holy. So it seems that the Chalcedonian Patriarchates in the East, Antioch, Jerusalem, and Alexandria, each in their own way, developed their own identity in the course of the 8th and 9th centuries, independently of Byzantium, consisting in an Arabic literature, a Malachite collection of canon law, and the maintenance of their own liturgy, for example, the liturgy of St. James in Jerusalem and of St. Mark in Alexandria. For Sidney Griffith, the Malachites are, I quote, Arabic-speaking Christians in the world of Islam who were nevertheless in communion with the Greek Orthodox whose faith they shared, unquote. And correspondingly, Griffith also speaks of an Arab Orthodox identity. Now to the first text, the life of Abd al-Masih al-Najrani. The life was written originally in Arabic, most likely in the second half of the 9th century. Nothing is known of the author beyond what can be deduced from the text itself. Probably he was a monk of the monastery of St. Catherine on Mount Sinai. The life is transmitted in a Sinai manuscript, Sinaiticus Arabicus 542, from the end of the 9th century. This is a hagiographical collection which could be interpreted as a monastic history of Mount Sinai for the edification of its community. In it, the sacred topography and its biblical history is commemorated, as well as the saintly monks who continued to live there. So the manuscript documents not only the transmission of hagiographic literature from Greek and Syriac into Arabic, as many older texts have been translated into Arabic in this collection, in the course of the 8th and 9th century, but also the construction of a new local identity by the Sinaitic monks, as André Bingeli has shown in its analysis of the manuscript. Beside many lives of and stories about pre-Islamic holy men from Sinai and the Near East, the collection contains also the life of Abd al-Masih al-Najrani, who lived in the first half of the 8th century. He was a Christian originating from Najran on the Arabian Peninsula. And now I start reading the text after the heading and the eulogy. It says, there was a man of the Christians of Najran, whose Christians were noble Arabs, called Rabia ibn Qais ibn Yazid al-Hassani. He was correct in worship, knowledgeable in what was his right and in what was his duty. Once upon a time, when he was 20 years old, wanting to pray in Jerusalem, he set out with some Muslims of the people of Najran, bent on wicked. On account of his association with them, they were continually beguiling him and misleading him to the point that he went with them on the raid. He was the best man to shoot an arrow, the most expert of people in striking with a sword, and the most skilled in thrusting with a spear. Ignorance and youth and bad companions brought him to enter Roman Byzantine, that means Byzantine territory, with a raiding party. He fought and did battle along with them. He killed, he plundered, he burned, and following their example, he engaged in everything forbidden. He prayed with them, and he became even more furious and harder of heart against the Romans than they. He persevered in this for 13 years, devoting himself to raiding every year. When these years were finished, he set out for certain cities of Syria to pass the winter in them. On noonday, he entered Baalbek, and on his horse he headed straight for a church there. He entered it and saw a priest sitting there at the door of the church reading in the gospel. He sat down beside him to listen. He said, "What are you reading, O priest?" The priest said and answered, I am reading the gospel. He said, translate to me what you are reading. And one manuscript adds, in Greek, Romania. So he translated for him, saying, whoever loves mother or father or brother or anything more than me, he is not worthy of me. When this was read, right then he wept and recalled what had been his estate and to what he had come, and then it goes on. And he actually confessed to the priest, returned to Christianity, and went to Jerusalem. And from Jerusalem he was sent by the patriarch to Mar Saba to take the monastic habit. From there he moved to Mount Sinai and finally became the first known Arabic hegumenous abbot of the monastery. He had the intention to make his apostasy public to become a martyr, but in contrast to Peter of Capitolinus, was at that occasion hidden from sight by God. Some years later, he was nevertheless recognized by one of his former raiding companions and was beheaded in Aramba on orders of the Muslim governor. But the life does not stop there, but continues to account how the bones of the saint were recovered by the Christians despite the efforts of the governor and then divided between Sinai and the church of Saint Cyriacus in Aramba. In the context of the hagiographical collection in which the text is transmitted, this life must be understood as an effort of the increasingly important group of Arabic monks in the monastic community on Mount Sinai to establish the cult of this hegumenos whose Arabic origin and tribal affiliation is stressed explicitly. Abd al-Masih belongs to the group of the so-called neo-martyrs, which were persons who either were put to death for their invective preaching against Islam or because of apostasy from Islam, as we've seen many examples of this already. According to Christian Sana, who is the expert for this group of saints, martyrs became again important in the early Islamic period because they served as a means for the Christians to make sense of their place in the new Islamic order by referring to the model of the old pre-Constantine church in persecution. So the Melkite church presented itself as a church of martyrs who remained faithful despite Muslim oppression. As in many other Melkite lives, here as well, Jerusalem is mentioned as a place where one was introduced in the monastic world, often by the patriarch himself. In general, the lives of holy men, and another example would be the life of Stephen Sabaitis, had as their purpose the commendation of the central institutions of the Melkite community in the world of Islam, such as the monasticism of the Judean desert, particularly the monastery of Mar Saba, and the centrality of the Patriarchate of Jerusalem as guarantors of orthodoxy. With regard to the story of conversion and its peculiar circumstances, it's quite impossible to decide if this actually happened. Abd al-Masih himself seems to have been a historical person, but the depiction of the saint as a seduced young man who became a kind of bandit or brigand reminds one of an adventure story and certainly served as a means to construct a stark contrast to the saintly life Abd al-Masih led after his conversion, maybe similar to the conversion of Saulus to Paulus. So it is questionable if this text could be used as a testimony for the frequency of such events, despite the fact that fictional texts are especially careful to put their story in a plausible context, however miraculous their content might be otherwise. One recurrent motif of these lives of neo-martyrs is, however, the conversion to Islam with a subsequent return to Christianity. But what was the function of this motif? Regarding neo-martyrs of the 14th and 15th centuries who had temporarily converted to Islam, Elizabeth Zachariadou is of the opinion that the church attempted in this way to warn the faithful against the conversion to Islam, as a return to Christianity inevitably entailed as penalty, capital punishment. This argument does not appear convincing, as a conversion is usually not depicted as a conscious act, since the saints were always very young at that moment, and also in the case of Abd al-Masih, it's said that he is young and ignorant. So rather what should count for this group of martyrs is that they should above all demonstrate that one can preserve one's Christian faith even under Islamic rule. The conversion of Islam is downplayed as something the individual is not accountable for because of his young age and the circumstances. So one could read these lives rather as an invitation for converted Christians to return to their former faith. These texts seem to say that conversion to Islam could happen under certain circumstances, but one has not to worry. One could always come back to Christianity. All sins will be forgiven. And actually, there is a letter of the Patriarch of Constantinople to the people in Asia Minor from the 14th century stating just ideas like this. The martyrdom, as such, does not serve as a deterrent. Rather, it illustrates the total commitment and the perfection of the respective saint. Now, come to the second source, the life of Elias of Heliopolis. Nothing is known about the anonymous author of the martyrdom of Elias of Heliopolis, which is written in Greek. But the author must have been a native of Syria and says of himself that he has written two other saints' lives. The dating of the text is disputed. The only manuscript is from the 10th, maybe 11th century. Since, according to Sidney Griffith, over the course of the 9th century, any Greek-speaking monks were hardly to be found in the Palestinian monasteries, and knowledge of Greek appears to have almost completely disappeared, the 11th or even the 11th century seems to be more likely, because the Byzantine reconquest of northern Syria in the second half of the 10th century and the establishment of the Ducaton of Antioch in 969 inaugurated a new phase of Byzantine influence in Syria and Palestine with far-reaching consequences for the Melkite Church. Greek clerics returned to northern Syria, and also probably the number of the Greek-speaking population increased, at least in the cities. While the Patriarchate of Antioch was now under the direct control of Constantinople, the Fatimid rulers of Cairo acknowledged in the 1030s the Byzantine emperor as the protector of the Orthodox Christians in the Holy Land, and it seems that also the Patriarch of Jerusalem was nominated from then on by the emperor. All this led to an intensive effort of Byzantinization of the Melkite Church, meaning a closer alignment in ritual and canonical matters of the Melkite Church to Constantinople. With regard to hagiography, two different developments of phases could be established. At first, on the local level, it seems that the Melkite literary production increased substantially, which actually could not be interpreted as an expression of forced Byzantinization. In the second half of the 11th century, however, quite another level of Byzantinization is reached with the adoption of the Byzantine Synaxarion. The Synaxarion is a liturgical book which lists for each day of the year the feasts of saints and other commemorations observed on that day. The oldest dated witness to this Arabic translation of the Melkite Synaxarion, is of the year 1095. Any form of a specific Melkite liturgical calendar was thus replaced by the calendar of Constantinople. The life of Elias begins with the account of Jesus forgiving the sinful woman who was bathing his feet with her tears. It is stated that just in the same way the sins of the neo-martyrs will be forgiven. Elias was born in 759 or 779 to a Christian family in Heliopolis, Baalbek, and trained as a carpenter. Together with his mother and two brothers, he left his native town for Damascus, where for 2 years he was employed by a Syrian who was still a Christian as Elias entered his service. But then this Syrian renounced his Christian faith, convinced by a Muslim magnate, the Muslim patron of the Syrian. As Elias, at the age of 12, was falsely accused of having converted to Islam. And now I start reading the text in paragraph 6. There's a feast, and Elias was called upon for service. Elias was about 12 years old. He served them, joking and rejoicing with them at the feast, inasmuch as he was an innocent child. The dinner guests, along with the patron of the apostate, turned to the martyr and said, "Where are you from, child? For we see you to be clever and willing to share our joy." The apostate responded, taking on the reply, "He is hired out to me in my craft, and as you can see, he is good." Laying hold of him separately, they said to the saint, "If you want, child, you too can renounce your Christian faith and can become just like us, continuing with your master no longer as a hired servant, but as a son." Immediately the saint replied, "You have gathered here to feast, not to other public speeches. Stop saying these things to me." They responded, "Meanwhile, come eat with us." Approaching with guilelessness and eating, the saint continued to serve them, when some stood up from the dinner and began dancing and taking hold of the saint. They persuaded him to dance with them. What is more, bending together, they loosened the saint's belt and threw it to the side at that time so that it would not prevent the body from easily being drawn to dance. Then the dinner of evil preparation came to an end. After the night passed, the holy great martyr Elias got up in the morning. Since all the dinner guests had slept together at the house, he girded his own belt according to the custom of the Christian community, and after washing his face, he departed the house and was on his way to pray to God. One of those still under the influence of the evening's intoxication called out and said, "Elias, where are you going?" The saint responded, "I am going to pray." Taking up the conversation, another one said to the saint, "And did you not deny your faith last night?" The saint disdained these words and without even turning around to the speaker, went to prayer. And then returning from there, he arrived at the workshop and there found the apostate. And the apostate said to him, "Indeed, Elias, if I had not prevented our companions, they would have caused you grief today because they say you denied Christ last night. But work and be without fear." The saint was amazed to hear these things and kept quiet for a short while. Then during the time of the midday meal, leaving the workshop, he went to his brothers and narrated to them what had happened to him. By decision of his older brother, along with his mother, they went to the apostate and said to him, "Men, behold, our brother has been working for you for a year and has not received any portion of his wages from you. Give us our fair portion, and our brother will depart from your service, for we have decided to send him back to Heliopolis, our homeland." The apostate said in response, "You are not due outstanding wages from hiring out the child, but neither will I release the child to leave my service, as he has apostatized from your Christian faith, and I have witnesses against him." So, finally, Elias was urged by his brother to leave Damascus for his hometown of Heliopolis until the rumor died down. Having followed his trade in Heliopolis for 8 years, Elias, now 20, deemed it safe to return to Damascus, where he opened his own workshop making camel saddles. However, his former employer had not forgotten the incident and asked Elias to enter his service again. As Elias declined, he was denounced out of envy by his former employer and taken to a Muslim official, the eparch of the town, who invited him to renounce his Christian faith. He was whipped and tortured and then dragged off to the governor, but again he refused to convert to Islam and he finally suffered martyrdom on February 1st in the year 779, or according to another calculation, 795. His body was left hanging on a cross for 14 days. The body was then to be incinerated but remained unharmed by the fire, so it was cast into the river, and nevertheless pieces of his relics were collected by pious Christians from Heliopolis, to some of whom the saint appeared in a vision. The text is of interest since it is set in a secular surrounding in contrast to the mostly monastic character of Greek and Malachite hagiography. It gives a vivid picture of the daily coexistence of Christians and Muslims in Damascus at the time of its origin. So in this case, one may assume that the life indeed gives some insight in the situation of Bimis and offers a new, unique glimpse of the social pressures experienced by Christians in everyday life. Elias did not suffer martyrdom out of fervent desire to witness his religion, as in many other lives of neo-martyrs. Actually, he never converted truly to Islam. Instead, he was a victim of defamation and of professional jealousy and soured relations with his former employer. The importance of work relations and economic factors becomes evident in this life. As a Muslim, Elias would have been no hired employee anymore. Later, the former employer, the apostate, is obviously trying to eliminate a new competitor in his trade. Thus, the author of the life wants to demonstrate to his audience the dangers of close associations with Christian apostates and Muslims. Furthermore, the importance of the outward signs of the Zimis status is demonstrated, since the fact alone that Elias loses his belt, the Zonar, was understood as a sign of his having given up his status at Zimi, which was seen as tantamount to the adoption of Islam. So we just heard about this in the Chronicle of Sukkim. What was the intended audience of this peculiar text? Obviously, a lay community. This means that the Greek text could not have been written before the Byzantine conquest of Antioch in 969, which led to a revival of the knowledge of Greek in Syria. On the other hand, the text suggests that it was not an original composition, but maybe was rewritten or even translated to Greek from Syriac or Arabic, as in the case of the life of Timothy of Kachushta, that was translated from Arabic to Greek in the second half of the 11th century. There are even indications that Elias might have been originally a Syrian Miaphysite saint. Then the original author could have been a bishop of a Syrian city, Melkite or Syrian Orthodox, who intended the text for its local, so to speak, middle-class community of craftsmen and the like. So while it seems safe to assume that the Greek text has not been written before 969, the dating of the supposed original version is unclear. Now, the last text, the Vita of Saint Lazarus, was composed by his disciple Gregory the Cellarer. Almost nothing is again known about Gregory, except that which he reveals of himself in the Vita he authors. Born in Constantinople and generally well educated, he was a younger disciple of Lazarus, who came to the monastery of Galatian near Ephesus to be a monk some time after 1030. Later he served as a cellarer of the monastery and wrote the life sometime after 1057. The life records the saint's birth in a village not far from Ephesus, probably in 967-68. At the age of 12, he was sent to a neighboring monastery where his uncle was a monk. With 18, he started a journey to Jerusalem, which he reached only after several years. He must have been about 25 or 26 when he arrived in Jerusalem, sometime between 991 and 993. Shortly after the destruction of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre on the orders of Al-Hakim in 1009, Lazarus decided to leave Palestine, having spent somewhere between 16 and 19 years in the Holy Land. And I start reading of the text on this page 103 of the translation. So the end of paragraph 19. When Lazarus and the other fathers saw this, the destruction of the Holy Sepulchre, they decided to leave the Holy Land. This was not so much because of this incident, but more because of the persecution taking place at that time, for the Muslims killed a lot of people, monks and laymen. Even worse, many people who were afraid of physical death, alas, died spiritually by denying their faith and calling themselves Saracens instead of Christians. Then I continue in paragraph 20. Since everyone was leaving, the father also decided to depart from the Holy Land with another monk called Paul and go to Rome, so he used to say. While they were still there at Jerusalem, however, some bad news reached them for the monk, who used to be Lazarus' fellow canonarchus, so a singer and a choir at the Lavra, the monastery of St. Sabas, had denied the Christian faith. The wretched man had abandoned his monastic habit and position and had gone off and become a Muslim. When the father heard this, he was very upset at the perdition of the brother and persuaded Paul to go with him and see this man wherever he might be. So they went out and found him, and when Lazarus saw him wearing Saracen clothes, he said to him through his tears, "Alas, brother, what do I see? Have you thus scorned your salvation by denying both your faith and your habit? Wasn't it for this very reason, that I was always telling you, when you were with me in the Lavra, not to make friends with the Saracens? Come, my beloved brother, come and turn back again to our compassionate God, our Lord Jesus Christ, who does not want the death of a sinner, but that he should turn back and live." The father said these words to him and others to lead him to repentance, but the man acted deaf and dumb and could not even look directly at them for shame. When the father saw him in this state, he spoke to him again. "What is it, brother? Won't you answer? Don't you realize that the good Paul here has also come for your sake? Give us any answer you want." Scarcely opening his mouth, the man replied to the father, "What can I say to you, brother, when I have got myself caught up in such evils? Even if I want to repent and follow you, I cannot, for if it should come to the knowledge of the local emir, he would kill me, and you too as well. But if you can go and persuade him to let me go, I'll come with you wherever you want." The father was glad when he heard these words and went off at once to the emir. He saw him, and after much tearful planning on behalf of the brother, persuaded him with difficulty to give him to them. Then taking him with them at night, so that it should not be known to any of the Saracens, for these were the emir's instructions, they started traveling through the desert. After they had got far enough away from the place they had left, they wanted to have a short rest and lay down on the ground and went to sleep. But that miserable and misguided former monk got up again when he saw that they were asleep and went back just like a dog to its own vomit. When Lazarus and Paul woke up and could not find him, they realized what he had done. They understood then that his mind was twisted and that his repentance was not on account of God, just as Judas was not. Thus, when Judas understood what he had done, he returned and cast down the silver pieces, and then, unable to bear his shame, fell into despair and went out and hanged himself. So in the same way, this man also pretended to repent when he was trapped by force of circumstances, but because he had been blinded by his despair and was unable to perceive the way of repentance and the compassion of Christ, he turned back again to the darkness of perdition. So the fathers got up and continued their journey through the desert, despairing of the salvation of that miserable man. After his return to Byzantine lands, Lazarus found himself back home near Ephesus around 1011. He decided to settle down as a stylite in that area, gathering continual disciples. Lazarus founded successively three monasteries on Mount Galatian, north of Ephesus, and he died in 1053. This text belongs to a totally different kind of text. It is not the story of a neo-martyr, and this was not written for Orthodox or Melkite Christians under Muslim rule. Rather, it is part of the long life of the founder of a flourishing, important congregation of monasteries in Byzantium. So its main purpose is to enhance the cohesion of this group, which is focused on its founder, who had also provided his monasteries with a rule for their life. Accordingly, the Vita of the Saint contains many examples and exhortations for the monks how to live properly. The story of the apostate monk is reported in the context of the report of Lazarus' doings in the Holy Land. Here, as in other cases, the life appears to be quite realistic in describing the persecutions of Al-Hakim and its consequences for the local Christians. The apostate monk, however, serves mainly as an example for a weak monk whose faith is not strong enough, a recurring motif in the life. He's all the time, admonishing monks in this life. At the same time, Islam is presented as an evil, false doctrine, and the Muslims are called in a stereotypical way sacrilegious, abominable, and dog-like. that the apostate monk did not return to Christianity despite Lazarus' offer to help him is solely attributed to his lack of faith in Christ and to a falling into despair rather than to any attraction Islam as a faith might hold for the man. So it seems the story is more an admonition for the monks not to despair and to be strong in their faith than about Islam. In general, this is not the main topic of Lazarus' life. The reference to the Holy Land serves mainly to demonstrate that the Palestinian monastic tradition is a model for the most supreme forms of asceticism practiced by the saintly founder, living as a stylite. But also explanations were provided in this text why this extraordinary man did not remain in the Holy Land, but returned to Byzantium. The topic of the violent Muslims is of major importance here. While the saintly founder was able to participate personally in the Palestinian tradition by actually going there, the regular monks of his foundation should rather stay where they are, in their monasteries. The text leaves no doubt that the future of Orthodox monasticism lay in Byzantium. Thank you.
Okay, our first respondent is Dr. Rakin Yukalis, who is the curator of the Islam and Middle East collection of the National Library of Israel, focusing on developing Israel men's research collection in this field and on building digitalization initiative as well as cultural and educational programs on Islam, the Middle East, and the Arab-Palestinian cultures in Israel. Rakin graduated cum laude from Princeton University in 1993 and received her MA and PhD from Harvard University in 2006. In comparative Islamic and Jewish studies. From 2005 to 2008, Yukalis was assistant professor of religious studies at Fairfield University in Connecticut, teaching Islamic studies and comparative religion. From 2008 to 2010, she was a Golda Meir postdoctoral fellow of the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. Her publications include several articles on medieval Muslim Jewish responses to religious innovations and a monograph on Islam in America post 9/11.
Thank you. I first want to situate my remarks in the context of my fields of study, since my research world is quite distinct from the material that we're looking at today. My focus is primarily on the intersection between texts and legal texts in theory and religious practice. But several centuries later in the Islamic world, in the Islamic Middle East. And so when I look at texts like these, I'm not going to provide insights on the original historical context or the Eastern Christianity, but I'm thinking about them in terms of how these texts help us understand formations of community, identity, and boundaries. Now, being separate from these historical periods and subjects gives me a kind of freedom to look at these texts first and foremost as literature. What we have are three very rich, distinct texts that cross three centuries in the Near East. So the first thing I would like to do is to reflect on narrative details in these stories, some of which Johannes has mentioned, I think they help us think about these broader questions of identity, conversion, strategies for survival. As Johannes mentioned this, so I think I'll just mention this in passing, and that is these stories tell us a tremendous amount about regular Christian-Muslim interactions and how intertwined life seems to be, how casual, social it seems to be. And to me, that helps us understand why religious writers and leaders would be so concerned about the temptations of conversion. I know in the material that I look at, Ibn Taymiyyah in the 14th century is still deeply concerned about Muslims getting too close to Christian practices. So these are very central, basic concerns of religious authorities when you have communities that are intersecting. And then the third piece that I want to think about continues Johannes's ideas about the functions of these texts in these communities, and how and why communities might preserve these stories, retell, recopy these stories. So first, if we think about these stories as literature, and they're wonderful stories. They're very dramatic, and they are very realistic, as Johannes mentioned, not in the sense of being historical, but in the sense of believable. In the first story, the young man who falls into brigandry, what's striking is that he's described as husn al-ibadah. He starts in a good, solid, pious place. His conversion seems to be a kind of side effect of his fall into a bad community. Youth, ignorance, bad friends, and perhaps the economic opportunities that come along with raiding. And then somewhere along the lines, he starts praying. So that this, I think it's true for all of these cases, the conversion happens off stage. And it's so remarkably different than the text we saw in the previous session, which is why it was so stark, where there's this very elaborate, in the Chronicle of Zuqnin, very elaborate theological, scriptural description of conversion, whereas in these stories, conversion is a kind of side effect of these social and economic interactions. In this case, you have this cowboy or brigand who comes back and happens upon an opportunity for religious redemption. And then the redemption story, the redemption part is much more detailed than the conversion part, right? There's a clear focus on the redemption part. And there's an underlying renunciation of his former material self for the return to a more spiritual Christian ways. And this Muslim equals materialistic and Christian equals spiritual recurs, I think, in three of these stories. The second story is also a wonderfully narrated story. Here we have a situation where you don't have this dramatic, fall and rise, but you have this constant pious hero. And the so-called conversion takes place in a very social setting, right? Where this young lad, the 12-year-old, is joking and rejoicing as well. He's very much a participant in this social interaction. Something happens on the dance floor. This removing of the belt, which is an obvious shirking, removing of the Christian identity of this young man. Since it's a Christian text, we don't have to say that, no, maybe he did convert. We don't have to read this as history and say maybe he did convert late into the night. But there was very free-flowing socializing going on, even though there's a clear hierarchy among the characters in the story. And then again, we see the Muslim environment is one of materialism, and the interaction between the Christians and the Muslims are defined by economic and social considerations. The young carpenter's master is willing to protect him from the others so long as it's a social issue. But once it becomes an economic issue, when the family comes back and demands wages, then his master turns on him. Ilias runs away and thinks he can escape the dangers. But the story, the end of the story, reminds us how vulnerable Christians are. They can always be spotted. And I know this is where the Islam hat here, but I couldn't help but remember stories told about Maimonides, who was spotted on there's a famous text by Ibn al-Qifti in his chronicles about Maimonides finally escaping Fez on his way to Akko and being spotted by someone he knows. Who says, no, that's Muslim. And so that speaks to this real vulnerability of Christians and Jews who try to navigate these terrains of always not being able to shed their past. The third text, we have the situation where our main protagonist is not the one who goes through this this rise and fall or this this story of conversion, but he witnesses. He's a witness, and what's striking, and this is a different kind of text, as Johannes has mentioned, that the recurring theme of dogs. If you read the whole text, the dogs show up earlier in the text. The dogs are just the army of I assume it's and Hakim, who are called dogs, who are set up on the church and burn it down, and then later when the monk goes back to being Muslims, right, he uses extraordinary language of like a dog returning to vomit. Mm-hmm. He's miserable. He's misguided. There's a clear link being made with the dog reference between this apostate and the Muslim conquerors, the Muslim tormentors. This is an example to me. This is a very striking story of a failure of a saint to successfully revert someone. Following this, the story that was not read about the monk and the two monks were able to wrest this this misguided fellow from the emir, which seems extraordinarily difficult, perhaps even miraculous, mm-hmm. that they were able to get permission from the emir to bring this this monk back to Christianity, and yet it was the monk's own failings which led to the failure. All three of these texts are tragic, have tragic endings. All three of them end badly. I'll come back to that point. But just to bring this all together, the common threads are we have really good dramas about real people, again, not necessarily historical, but realistic. Conversions happen in an ancillary way. It's a natural, almost a natural byproduct of two close friendships, of too much interaction, which I see as a very clear warning, right? You definitely have this on the Muslim side, by reformists who are worried about these issues of always warning about, starting in from Quranic passages, but how those passages are used about don't be friends with the Christians and the Jews. The stories don't smooth over the dangers of reverting to Christianity. They all die at the end. I mean, coming from a Jewish background, I was talking to Johannes about this earlier, and he said, that's what martyrologies are, That's what happens. It's good, they die. To me, it's but they die. They all die. The realism of the peril of reversion is to me very, very profound. And so the question is, what are these texts supposed to elicit? What are their purpose? When I think about how these texts were used, with this is kind of chutzpahdik to think about that without actually knowing what happened to these texts. But in thinking about how communities preserve texts, I went back to my friend and colleague's work, Sarah Savant, who has a wonderful book called The New Muslims of Post-Conquest Iran, where she looks at traditions of the Persian, the post-conquest traditions around Persia, and plays with the two categories of remembering and forgetting, and pointing out, and in her case, what she demonstrated was, in order to make space for their new Muslim identity, Persians both forgot elements of their past and remembered other elements of their past, the ones that fit together with their new Muslim identity. And so the question for us is, when we examine stories like these, we also want to think about what stories aren't being told in these communities, which gets back to this question of what their functions are. I was struck, Johannes, by your saying that these texts are comforting, that you can always come back to Christianity and your sins will be forgiven. I would love to hear you speak more about that, because that seems counterintuitive to me, both because they die at the end, but also because the audience of these texts are probably not going to be the Christian converts to Islam. The people who are hearing these texts are the ones who are either in danger of being tempted, right? And so then it functions more as a kind of warning. Or, you know, those who are far removed and safe in a monastery in Byzantine territory. Whether, you know, are these comforting texts? Are these warning texts? What do we do with the fact that they seem very, very starkly realistic? You win some, you lose some. But what's clear is that these texts seem to me attempts to work out strategies for how do you try to keep your community together under this constant vulnerability. The periods we're looking at are between 9th and 11th century, where we're still in the periods, if I understand correctly, we're still in the periods where Christians make up a sizable percentage of these near certain countries or areas, if not the majority. And so, there might still have been a sense that all was not lost, that there was still a possibility of keeping the communities intact, preserving the communities under the face of this constant threat, which sounds much more like the threat of temptation than the threat of forced conversion, but very much a constant threat in a lot of these communities. Thank you.
The last respondent is Dr. Yuval Rotman, who is a senior lecturer, Department of Jewish History, Tel Aviv University. He is a social historian of the Byzantine Mediterranean world. Within this framework, he has worked on slavery, captives, ransoms of captives, cultural and social relationships between religious communities of different faith and religious conversion. His book on Byzantine slavery was first published in French in 2004 and then in English by Harvard University Press in 2009. His book on insanity and sanctity, the ambiguity of religious experience, studies different forms of social abnormality and their sanctification in the Byzantine Near East. It goes to press at Harvard University Press.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the organizer. I'm very happy to be here to respond to the three fascinating texts that Johannes brought. I'm presenting the Byzantine, let's say, point of view, or I'll try to present it as much as I can, about this narrative of Christian inhabitants of the Muslim world who are facing conversion and either refuse or come back to Christianity. Since then, by three, what we said before, three hagiographic texts. So I would like to raise three points or a few points and to address two aspects. The first aspect is the literary representation of this figure, the convert figure. And the second aspect is the actual conversion process, information that we can get about, not about a geographic representation, but actually the process itself. So the three points I would like to raise are the first two, well, all of the three will concern Byzantine representation and Byzantine source, major Byzantine sources of the same period. The first point will be how Byzantine narratives of the same period refer to this theme, the theme of Christian, but not Christian inhabitants of the Muslim world, but Christians, Byzantine Christians, who were faced, who were facing the same situation, a conversion or a threat of conversion to Islam. So this will be the first, my first point. The second point would be how this. Okay, so the second point, fine? Okay, good. So the second point would be how the same literature, how the same authors, I mean Byzantine authors, Christian authors, refer to Muslims who convert to Christianity in Byzantium or in Islam. And the third point would be not about literary representation, but actually about information that we have about the conversion process itself, that we can confront or with the literary representation in Byzantine text. So, the first point is how Byzantine sources, Byzantine authors, Byzantine hagiographers, Byzantine texts referred to Christians, inhabitants of the Byzantine world who confronted Islam. So first of all, how can they confront this threat of Islam? And this brings us exactly to the first narrative of Abdul al-Masih, who participate in raiding. And of course, there's not much here about the raiding itself. I mean, it says that he's raiding, of course, Roman territory, which means Byzantine territory. And part of this raiding is not just spoils, but part of the spoils is also Byzantine inhabitants who are taking as captives, who are taking as slaves, reduced to slavery, and then sold in in Muslim territories to either Christians or Muslim, whoever wants to buy them. Now, this was the situation starting from the 9th century until the 11th century in all the Mediterranean regions of the Byzantine Empire, starting from Asia Minor, especially when Cyprus was in Arab hands, the Peloponnesus, the Adriatic, when the Arabs were in Sicily also, and the other, when the Arabs got Crete. So this was something that happened all the time and is described by historiography, but Byzantine historiography, and also in territory, in land territory in Asia Minor. So to respond to this situation, and to respond to the fact that so many Byzantines are being victimized by Muslim raids and are taken and reduced to slavery, and then, of course, confront a threat to convert to Islam, Byzantine hagiography invented a new type of, well, invented, I mean, revisited a new type of saint, the captive saint, who is taken victim, who is raided and is then enslaved and is sold in a Muslim land. And we have a few lives, a few vitae of this kind of saints, all ranging from Mediterranean regions of the Byzantine world. I would like to raise just one. I would like to present just one text, maybe the most elaborate text, which comes from Italy, from Calabria. This is the life, the 10th century life of Saint Elias the Younger, who is a Sicilian actually. And when he is a boy, he has a dream, a revelation in which his destiny is revealed to him, and he will be taken twice into Muslim lands as a slave, and he will be then his mission will be to spread Christianity in Arab, in Muslim land. And of course, this comes true. The first time he is saved by the Byzantine ship that brings him back. Second time he is less fortunate, and when he's a boy. He comes to Ifriqiya and is sold to a slave. Luckily, we'll get to this point afterwards.
he's sold to a Christian master in Ifriqiya, who makes him one of his best trusted men in his household. He is tempted, seduced by the wife of his master. He, of course, resists temptation. And later on, he becomes so powerful in his own household that he's unable to redeem itself, I mean, to buy his own freedom. And then he goes to a mission, to a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. And on his way, he encounters Christians and Muslims, and he tries even to convert. I mean, he is faced with tempted to convert to Islam. Of course, he resists the temptation, and not only resists the temptation, but he even manages to convert Muslims to Christianity, and this pilgrimage brings back afterwards to the Byzantine world. So this is a very elaborated text, a text of like a few dozens folios, that shows what the Byzantines, how the Byzantines looked at this kind of situation. This theme is repeated in a few other vitae, where the saint itself is the protagonist itself. The saint itself is enslaved and captive in Muslim lands. However, other texts, other Byzantine texts, portrayed another kind of picture about saints, Byzantine saints, who go to Muslim lands in order to redeem Christians, Byzantine Christians, who are being held as by Muslims in Arab lands and are threatened by with conversion to Islam. So this is the first point of view that I wanted to raise. I just want to relate that to also to the life of Elias of Heliopolis, in the fact that why the question of slavery, because we saw that, you know, that the master of Elias present the apostate, present him as his working man, and after that they have all this kind of discussion about the slavery. I think my hypothesis is that Byzantine sources refrain from presenting the saints as a slave to a Muslim and pick like slavery to a Christian, local Christian in Muslim lands, in order to not to elaborate the question about a Christian slave of a Muslim, whether he would be considered automatically as a Muslim, as a convert to the Muslim, because this is what the situation was in Byzantium as far as the Muslims were concerned. So this is the first. The second point I want to raise is about how Byzantine literature treat Muslims who are faced with conversion to Christianity this time, and here we come to the parallel side of the first point, which is the Byzantine raids into Muslim lands, who brought captives. And these captives were, of course, faced with the possibility of conversion to Christianity. So we have a few of these texts. The most elaborate and most wonderful text is the Byzantine epic of dated to the 10th century, the Tigenis Akritas, who is actually a Muslim raider, an emir, who raids Byzantine territories, and one of his victims is a Byzantine girl, who, of course, a virgin, and he falls in love with her. And she convinces him, and also her brothers convinces him, to leave, renounce Islam, and to convert to Christianity. And the story continues. This is just like the first book of this. But we have other anecdotes similar to that in other Byzantine sources, not only a geography, also historiography. In the writing of Constantine VII, the Porphyrogenitus, he writes about the possibility offered to Arab Saracen captives to renounce Islam, to marry Byzantine women, girls, and to be settled on the borders as Byzantines, and as long as they renounce Islam and convert to Christianity. And the last anecdote that I wanted to raise here about this this type of conversion comes from an Arab source, and I thought of presenting it because the beautiful narratives about Abul al-Masih. And this is an anecdote from the Kitab al-Arani of al-Isfahani about an envoy sent by the caliph to redeem Muslim captives held in Constantinople. And this is a narrative that says how he strolled the streets of Constantinople, and suddenly on a mule, and suddenly he hears a beautiful chanting of a Quranic verse coming from one of the houses. And of course he's marveled to hear this praying, Arabic praying in the Byzantine city. So he searches the house, he gets into the house, and he sees this man on the floor weeping and reciting the same verses all over again. And he presents himself and he asks this person who he is. And this person tells him that he's actually a captive that came from Muslim territories and was persuaded to convert to Christianity and married and stayed in Constantinople, but he's missing Islam, he's missing in his homeland. So the envoy, of course, suggests to redeem him because that is his mission. But the man says that now he's already married, he has two children, I think, yes, and that he cannot renounce the Christianity and go back to Islam. Like that. So this is the second point that I wanted to raise.
That's the end of it? That's the end of that story?
Yes.
He doesn't go back to Islam.
No, he doesn't go back to Islam. And this is actually a very nice example of how the Byzantine and the Arabic sources are different.
Yes.
In portraying more complex situation with the Muslim sources. But of course, it is like a very the literary form is the issue here. So, finally, last point. The last point that I wanted to say is concerning the real conversion. I mean, the conversion, because we spoke about three types. Ah, sorry, I forgot to mention also that Al-Masudi also mentions 12,000 Arab cavaliers who desert and move to the lines of the Byzantines in the 10th century. So the third point that I wanted to raise concerning the apostasy itself, the conversion process. And here I would like also, in here I'm addressing also the discussion that was held in the previous panel about the abjuration formula. Abjuration formula in which appear as appendices in Byzantine prayer books. We have five manuscripts like that from the 11th century onward, and normally it's not just a very short formula. We are talking about 60 folios in each of these manuscripts of formula for abjurations, divided between formulas to Jews, to Muslims, to Saracens, to different kinds of Christian heresies, to Manichaeans, to pagans, of course. These formulas have a lot in common in the ritual, but part of the ritual is to abjurate, to anathematize the principles of the religion from which you are coming, of course. How much time do I have?
You can start one, 2 minutes.
Not much time. Okay, so I won't go into the ritual. I will just read you the articles of the anathema for the Muslims, which I copied from the narrator, summarized and copied. And I'm doing that because, of course, it has four topics. The first is, of course, abjuration of Muhammad and his followers and the Quran. The second is the abjuration of the Muslim perception of paradise. The third is the abjuration of the Muslim perception of Jesus and the biblical figures according to the Muslims, of course. And the fourth is the abjuration of Muslim rituals. And I want to describe them because they appear to have some kind of like very unique features that I don't know how to pinpoint them. That's one thing. And the other thing that I, my other objective is to ask you whether you think that this kind of anathema could have been, I mean, we have like all the manuscripts that we have of this are Greek manuscripts coming from Byzantium. We don't have any, as was said before, we don't have any, well, we have the Coptic, but we don't have any Syriac. So, and my question is whether these kinds of articles in the anathema could not have been, could have been problematic under Muslim rule. So, here is the anathema of Muhammad and his followers. So I renounce Muhammad, Ali, his Ali's, Abu Bakr, and so on. All the followers of Muhammad renounce the four wives of Muhammad with the names. Some, and this is very interesting, some adds to his daughter Fatima, and we'll see that below because some of the, just a second. Yes, some of the manuscripts that we have, I think three out of five refer also to the two sons of Ali, to Hussein and Hassan, which are not in the in the most earlier manuscript that we have. So anathema of the perception of the paradise, or the paradise of Muhammad, as it is called in the text. So to the four rivers of water, milk, wine, and honey. To the fact that I renounced the candidate anathematized the fact that the Muslim will live in the paradise with their wives under trees, and we will eat the most beloved birds and fruits. Their body will raise to the sky, and the genitalia will reach 40 feet high. And we will spend the time in, of course, orgies. Anathemas of religious figures, of the angels, according to Muhammad, and of all the lies that Muhammad told about the Old Testament, or about Noah and Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Joseph, etc., etc. Anathemas of Jesus, according to the Islam, the fact that he was born from Mary, this Moses' sister, that he was a prophet and not just the God's son, and that was when he was a child, he created birds out of mud and then life into them, which is actually from the Surah table. Renouncing of his miracle, and renouncing the fact that he was he was not crucified. Yes, and anathema of the rituals, the Muslim rituals. So. Let's see, of course, the Hajj and the stones that the Muslims throw there on Christian, the circumcision, circumventing, I'm just translating here, it's not written in Hebrew, it's not written in English. So the circumventing of the Kaaba with the hand, right hand on their ears and the left hand on the stone until they fainted out. The worship for the sun of Lucifer and Aphrodite. The prayers of Muhammad and the anathema of the jihad. The anathema of the creation of Adam according to the Quran. And of all the perception of the stars as cavaliers. And anathema of the predestination according to the Quran. And finally, I'm et cetera, the final clause that repeats in all of these anathemas of different kinds of version. So, as Johannes suggested before in the discussion that, of the last panel, this anathemas and this abjuration formula could be related to the regions that. That Byzantium has conquered from the Arabs, and to the fact that it found itself with so many Muslims under its rule, and needed to come up with this kind of a procedure, how to deal with them. The peculiar thing is that you have some kind of invented features into them. This is one thing, and the other thing is, of course, how and in what way this could be reintegrated into other churches outside of Byzantium. So, thank you very much.
Okay.
let's start a discussion.
Maybe a short reply. I think referring to Michael, that actually is easy. Formation of community identities and boundaries, that's the main point of this text. And the problem is that the people, they tend to mix with the others, with the unbelievers, but the leadership of the communities, they try to prohibit this and to keep the community together. And so they are warning for too much, warning of too much interaction. And then, do these stories end badly or not? As you've mentioned, I think, you know, if the saint is becoming a martyr, that's a good thing for him. So I would say they do not end badly. To illustrate more better what I wanted to say about this idea that these stories are about the possibility to return to Christianity, I will quote this letter of the Patriarch of Constantinople to the Christians of Nicaea from 1338. And in this letter, he says, dealing with the threat of conversion, but now with the toleration of God through the great number of our sins, the attack of the Ismailites, the Muslims, has overwhelmed us. They have taken many of our people prisoner, reduced them to servitude, and dragged them away with force, so that as a consequence of this, woe betide us, they also chose their wickedness and godlessness, so they convert to Islam. And, but then he mentions that when these apostates became aware of what evil they had been caught up in, they returned back to Christianity. And then the Patriarch assured them that those who had abandoned their faith would nevertheless obtain salvation if they were to repent and return to Christianity. And those who did this in public and thus would suffer for having done so were promised the crown of martyrs as a reward, so that those who will do this in public, they will be promised the crown of martyrs. But also those who, out of fear of punishment, want to live as Christians by themselves and in secrecy, would obtain salvation, he says. So I think that's the idea of it. It could happen that you convert to Islam if you're young and so on and ignorant, but then you can return back, your sins will be forgiven. Maybe if you don't want to become a martyr, you should keep a low profile, but that is possible and acceptable for the church. I think that's my interpretation of these texts. Yeah. And with regard to the things Yuval mentioned, maybe one could also put the abjuration formula, the first version of it from the end of the 9th century, into context with Nicators of Byzantium, who wrote several treatises polemics against Islam, and in his works are included quite lengthy citations of the Quran in Greek. So there is evidence, obviously, for a Greek translation of the Quran from, let's say, the 9th century. And so we can see that in this period, when the Byzantines began to reconquer Asia Minor and then later northern Syria, there is also, so to speak, an ideological propaganda war going on. So.
Thank you, Hannes, and wonderful comments. The Life of Elias is my favorite martyrology. I think it's the most fun and kind of bizarre story. I disagree slightly with the dating of the text. It doesn't affect its content or at all analysis of what it has to say, but I think it's probably earlier than 969. That's my personal opinion. I think that for a few reasons. The manuscript that it appears in is very unique. It actually contains three martyrologies which are only attested in that manuscript. This is a manuscript in Paris for the Bibliothèque Nationale. It also contains the Passion of the 60 Martyrs of Jerusalem. And it also contains the 20 Martyrs of Marsabe, a text that Stephen Shoemaker has translated in his book that's coming out. And what is unique is that these three texts strike me not at all as being Byzantine, but rather as being Palestinian and Syrian. There doesn't seem to be much of a fingerprint of Byzantine culture or Byzantine concerns. So for example, there are certain neo-martyrologies that may have origins in Palestine, but which have recensions outside, and they'll often, you'll see mention of the Byzantine emperor, dating at the beginning of the text will be a reference to who's ruling. There's nothing like that in any of these three texts, including Elias. And one would assume to find something like that if it had been after 969. So that's one thing. I think it's also telling that none of the Byzantine synaxaria mentioned this Elias. The only ones are from inside the caliphate. The Palestinian Georgian calendar has them. But I do agree with you that there's interesting evidence that this text may have been written in Syriac or another language before. And the reason I got this idea from Andre Bengeli on linguistic grounds that I don't totally understand, and that I think he himself was sorting out. He said the Greek is very simple, actually, and it's rather, it's idiosyncratic in a lot of ways. And he said he felt like there was certain evidence in the text that it had come from another language before Greek. In that manuscript that all of these texts appear in, it's telling, I think, that the life of the passion of the 60 martyrs of Jerusalem is allegedly on the basis of an Aramaic forlaga. The text itself states that at the end, that the author found this. It says that it's written in a language, Syros, which I take as some dialect of Aramaic. I don't know if it's Syriac or Christian Palestinian Aramaic. So contextually, there may be an argument there, too, that this comes. But I wondered what I guess my concrete question is, you mentioned you thought it may have come from a Miaphysite context. So I wondered why you thought that.
Yeah, I have this from article of McGrath, where also the translation is could be found. And she mentioned, I have don't remember exactly, she mentioned that the Saint Elias is also mentioned in a Syriac text. Is there some kind of calendar? I don't remember exactly. So he was also, venerated by the Syrian Orthodox Christians. And so, I mean, I think my question would be, if the Greek text is before 969, so what's about the statement of Sidney Griffiths that we do not have Greek language speakers in that area anymore, and in the 9th and early 10th century? So, but the text is, I think that's convincing, the text is written for a lay community. Mm. So do we have a lay community in that area before 969? So I think the Vorlage might be, or it's probably much it's earlier, but why should it be translated into Greek before that? That's my problem.
I mean, the 20 Martyrs of Marsabe is a Greek text that is written at the turn of the 9th century at Marsabe itself.
Turn of, so 800. Yeah, but that's, so to speak, the end of Greek knowledge, according to Griffiths.
Yeah, and this martyrdom takes place in 779. I mean,
so you would say, okay, that the Greek version is already as old as this?
I wouldn't put my neck on the fact that this is written in Syriac first. I mean, the most we can say is that it's an early Greek text. And for me, it's part of this last flourishing of it's not high Greek literature in the way that the 20 Martyrs of Marsabe. That's a difficult Greek text. This is someone with great command of, Greek style. It is not true of the one that you presented, but nonetheless, I see it as part of this last gasp of sort of Syro-Palestinian Greek culture before it is eclipsed by Arabic. So that's the way that I would read it. I just don't see many Byzantine concerns in the text that you would expect to find if it was from post-969. But again, this doesn't affect the reading of the content.
Maybe one should compare to this Timothy of Kahushta, yeah. The Greek version. I don't know how much Greek, Greek things are in that, Byzantine things are in that text, which also was translated into Greek in the 11th century, mm-hmm. coming from Arabic. So, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, thanks. It's interesting how in actually three comments in the text, the issue of family and social interactions come up in different ways, but they come up every time in each one of your remarks. And in some places, the family is something that must be you must get over it. In the text itself, it's called, you know, somebody who prefers a wife children over me doesn't even deserve me. The story in Arani, where he answers actually the other way around, he chooses his family over his faith. And as you mentioned, these are all parts of the social interactions that are happening, and constitute all kinds of blocks or stop the people from converting, or on the other hand, create the situation for conversion. So I want to understand if you have identified any topoi regarding this, and can we say something about much more general patterns in terms of how this is discussed in the literature?
So I would not be able to point to specific examples or motives, but maybe I'm thinking about what you asked, for which audience is this would be these texts if they are not a warning, you know, against conversion. So for which audience? So that might have something to do with families. So that that these texts are for the Christian community, certainly not for the converts as such, but maybe for the larger family of a convert. So they could read this and they could try to reach out to their family member which has converted to Islam. So maybe it's like you can see it in this context. I think also the convert as an agent is also maybe that's a topic. The carpenter, the Syrian carpenter, he converted to Islam, and he is the main agent for this, you know, temptation of the young boy. So these converts are dangerous people, so to speak. Yeah.
I have to admit, I'm kind of fascinated by the way the Muslims are portrayed, particularly in the last text, the text of the and the interaction with, which you mentioned as well, which is quite amazing, with the Emir, who, I know that as you suggested, that this text is written for an audience living outside of the Muslim ambit, but at the same time, it seems to suggest that, you know, that you can do business with the Muslims, right? There's even their emir, right? Someone who's converted, you can go to the emir, and the motive of tears appears through all the, but you can get him, to, you can get a monk or someone who's converted to come back to Christianity. Have you got other examples of this? Is this unique? Is it when you think of later interaction, I think in the Western world with Islam, Christians going to Tunis and trying to do all sorts of, or Africa, don't get such a nice reception.
Yeah, but I think you've mentioned that already. I think that's a kind of miracle, you know. That's what the saint is able to do. He could go to the emir and, you know, get a free passage for this apostate, and then it's just, I mean, the apostate himself who is too weak and who is a bad example for the monks in Mount Galilee. But I wouldn't say that this is something we should not draw conclusions from this example. I think that's a specific ability of the saint.
Yeah, it's not portrayed as something miraculous. I mean, I would have suspected that, okay, you know, this is the saint was did this miracle and was able to persuade the.
Yeah.
It's almost as if it's been negotiation. It's like, okay, you can have him back.
It's not explicitly marked as this, but I mean.
But it does, I'm sorry, it does come after the apostate monk saying, what do you want me to do? I'm stuck now, I can't come back, I'll get killed. Right? That's the reality is laid out in front of him, and then somehow the monk can free him.
Yeah, but in hagiographies, in other, in, for example, in Western hagiographies, you find that there are lots of miracle stories accompanying, and here it doesn't seem to be, I mean, I don't know what, if there are other miracle stories,
I mean,
to Lazarus?
Sure. This is a Vita of I don't know, like 100 pages. You know, it's a very explicit story of the life of the saint, written as I've said for the monks. How he the life in the Holy Land, where he just get acquainted to all these Palestinian monastic traditions, and then how he founded the monastery and. His daily contacts with his monks, you know, and they are coming false monks, and he, you know, immediately is noticing that they have, you know, that they are false and that they have bad, you know, things in mind. And so, as you said, they have just been persecuted by Al-Hakim, so there's much of violence. And then suddenly he goes to the emir, and with difficulty, but nevertheless he succeeds. So that's, I would say. So maybe it's not a miracle, but a special ability to convince or something.
Yeah. And this appears also in other Byzantine texts about saints who go to Muslim lands in order to redeem Byzantines or the hell. The same with I mean negotiation with the emirs, and not on a miraculous basis at all.
I mean, can I only think of one example of St. Francis who goes to that's much later, of course, but I think only.
Not so
but he
successful.
Was not converted. He's not a convert.
No, well,
he was
trying to die as a martyr, but
he was not converted. He came
that's
as a Christian and he left. Him.
That's a miracle. So maybe one remark to because the, how the Muslims are presented, and you mentioned they are presented always as dogs, and the interesting thing more or less at the same period there's a famous Arabic poet Abu Firas al-Hamdani, and in his poets he wrote in Byzantine captivity. He is calling the Byzantines always Kalb Arum. So he's not saying the Byzantines or the Byzantine, he says, just says Kalb Arum.
Speaking about Topoi, I was struck by the, in the first text, by the way the young man comes back to Christianity. When he gets into the church and he asks the priest what he is reading. I mean, it's a very famous motif. Of course, probably the most famous conversion story of Augustine is he opens a book and he reads a sentence from the Bible. And he converts at that moment, this is the moment, and it happens to him when he remembers how St. Anthony was converted. St. Anthony was going by a church and he had the gospel being read and the verses, you should leave your mother and father and go after me, and he does it. And then Augustine does the same. And here too, I mean, this young man, he's a bandit. He goes, he's busy raiding. And
he's a retired bandit, I think.
Yeah.
Emeritus.
What is he doing?
He's
not St. Augustine who is already... he doesn't know if to be a Manichae or to be a Christian, and he suffers so much because this one is, you know what he's doing. And then he comes to the church, and the other motive is the Jerusalem motive. He too, he is going to Jerusalem to pray, and on his way he met some bad guys and becomes bad guys, Muslim guys, and he goes with them. And the other one is in the last story too, he goes to Jerusalem. So it is quite dangerous to go to Jerusalem. Really, yeah, because you better stay at home and worship your God. And as Gregory of Nyssa already said in the fourth century, don't go on pilgrimage.
Yeah, I mean that's the point. There are a number of Byzantine lives of saints from the 11th and 12th century, of founders of monasteries who lived a very ascetic life, and they are going to Palestine to get these to experience this original Palestinian monastic tradition, but only them, not their monks. Their monks should stay at home because they are special people,
yeah, so exactly what happened to Gregory of Nyssa in the 4th century. He went to Jerusalem, he came back and told them, everybody, don't go there. Yeah. And don't go at all, and you should stay here. And again, Bernard of Clairvaux, yes, when he says that the same skies are open over Jerusalem and over Clairvaux and wherever you are. And of course, what's his name, Boniface, when he said to the nuns that they should stay at home and not go to Rome or to Jerusalem, because there is no one city in Jerusalem in Italy where you cannot find a nun who is now a prostitute. So better stay at home.
But I think this motive from Anthony, St. Anthony, I think that's very convincing. That this is a model for this story as well, because actually the quotation of the father and the mother does not make much sense here, because there is no family around him. You know, he does not have to leave his family. He has left them already. So that makes sense. That is just
a motive
that
comes.
Hi, yeah, thank you for an interesting talk. I was wondering what, if anything, you think there's to be made of the fact that, as far as I can tell, there are no explicit confessional markers in any of these lives, and the conversion seems to be a very generic Christianity.
Sorry, I didn't get this.
No confessional markers in these lives.
Generic, yeah.
Nothing in the stories can I suggest the professional identity or affiliation of their heroes.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, just think about it. As I've said, Elias is presented as it could be a Syrian Orthodox text or Melkite text. It's not totally. It's not mentioned. In the first text of Abd al-Masih, as I said, it's a recurrence to the Patriarch of Jerusalem and to Mar Saba, so that's so it's pointing to the Melkite, to the most important Melkite institutions. So not about theology or something, but about the institutions of the Melkite Church. So that's very Melkite, and with Lazarus, he's anyway, it's a Byzantine text. So there's probably in these 100 pages, probably there is some theology in it, but I mean, this is a different kind of text.
You can also ask, why would there need to be confessional markers? I mean, it's meant for a particular audience, it's a discussion or it's a dialogue within the community. They don't need to tell each other who they are, I think.
But I would think that when you live in an interconfessional where there is a sectarian, where there are other confessions around, that this would be an opportunity to score some points, so to speak, to your own community. And also, I think that there could be...
But there is, in that sense, there is identification. The other confession, the confessional other, in this case, is the Muslim. And plenty of points are scored there. it's not a interdenominational competition here. So we're Christian, we don't need to specify our particular dogma. So I wouldn't expect confession.
No, I mean, it depends on the purpose. And this text are more about the confrontation Christians, Muslims. There also are other lives, like the Timothy of Kahushta, Theodorus of Edessa, the fictional life, which is more about, you know, inter-Christian things. So, depends just on the function of the specific text.
There's only one martyrology that I know of that makes explicit reference to inter-Christian sectarianism. I think for the reasons that Uli said. Basically, the other is the Muslim. The text is an Armenian text that describes a martyrdom that happens in Syria. And at the end, there's a dispute that arises as to who gets to control the body of the saints, and the Chalcedonians, the Nestorians, the Jacobites. But this is a very, very rare reference. Basically, they are blind. These texts are, as a genre, blind to intra-Christian sectarianism.
But I think at the same time these texts were being written, I think there are other texts that show that there was interconfessional competition going on.
Yeah, I'm not saying it wasn't there.
No. What I'm saying is, though, so my question is really to the point is, why is that left out of this genre?
I would say that the genre is important also for interconfessional, you know, boundaries. But maybe that's not so much in the text, but it's more in the calendars, you know, at which date you will celebrate this feast, and which version of the life will you have, you know. There are different versions which maybe are not so much different in their, you know, confessional content, but, you know, they are different. So hagiography and calendars are important for group identity as well, but maybe not so much with regard to their content.
But if I could just add one small thing, it is interesting in this respect that there are several saints who appear on the calendars of many different churches. So the most famous of these is a Muslim convert to Christianity. He's born as Raouq of Qurayshi, allegedly a member of the Prophet's tribe. The earliest martyrologies come from a Chalcedonian, from a Melkite context like these texts. But then he pops up in the calendars of the Miaphysites and others. He pops up in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, which is a Miaphysite church. And there are other examples of that. And so I think my takeaway is that these are figures that really transcend sects at a moment when there's huge competition in nearly every other respect, as you say.
I would just add to this that it seems that piety is an area where a lot of times these sort of sectarian identities don't get expressed. So I think, for instance, of Mary. I mean, Mary, with the controversies over the stories, you'd think there'd be axes to grind all the time. But Sebastian Brock has this great article on it. It's just not there, right? My brain isn't functioning as well as it should. But I can think of this in other respects. I mean, that having the saints' days that are across different boundaries. And I think of a figure like Isaac of Nineveh, right? I mean, all three of the confessions, this is someone who is adored, even though he's very clearly placed within one tradition. And so maybe this idea of these martyrs, as veneration and pious esteem, kind of fit with that tendency as well.
Well, because I mean, the way I'm thinking about it, it seems to me that this could be not just that they didn't feel a need to, because they were talking to a particular audience, but there could be a strategic element to this. That this is a genre in which it made strategic sense to sort of elide differences as opposed to emphasize them as you would in other more polemical texts.
I mean, there's a term that, if you follow the situation of Christianity in the Middle East today, you know, the Pope recently used a term that I think describes this. He talks about the ecumenism of blood. And one wonders whether in the context of an early Islamic world where there's this perceived persecution, and also real persecution, perceived as the important, that these differences are will pass down in the interests of certain ecumenism.
But I still would not underestimate the, you know, the differences between the communities, especially Mary. The date where you celebrate Dormition is very different, I think, in the Coptic and the Orthodox Church. And
but that's not a confession. That's just a different history in the development of the beast. It's pre-Chalcedonian.
Yeah, but it's a different date, and that probably I would suppose this means something. And for example, there is the celebration of Easter. For some reason, I don't know why, the Greeks and the Syrian Orthodox, at least in the Middle Ages, every 93 years they have a different Easter year. And we have in the chronicles of the 11th and the 12th centuries, every 93 years, we have reports about big clashes, even fightings, even the war in Armenia is to break out because they have different Easter dates. So I would assume these things are very important. So they say maybe the texts are the same, but the Melkites would still say, I mean, this is our say, it's not theirs. We celebrate it on that day in this way and not in this way.
This
change subjects since, but representing the Muslim side here, I say that to convert to Islam, you don't need to hear a specific verse. Any old verse would do, and it's a prominent topos, the conversion in the action to the sound of the Quran recited. And it really doesn't have to be specific verse. The belief is that the text affects me by its mere sound in a very profound way. Mm-hmm. And it's one of the most important companions of the Prophet and the second Caliph, Omar, converts famously, having overheard the Quran recited behind the closed door of his sister's house. We have this, it's a recurring theme. I know of a little anecdote from the 13th century of the Hanbali scholar Abdul Ghani al-Maqdisi, who is grieved to find out that he has dined with a Shamsi, some sort of pagan, at a friend's house. And he gets up at night and he recites the Quran. And in the morning, the guy tells him that he has converted, that he will convert, having heard the Quran recited.
Okay.
And a point regarding the what do those stories about reversion tell us? And you're very convincing, saying that those stories have a didactic message. Perhaps most important that a convert cannot be trusted. The stories that Osama ibn Qudama, Osama ibn Munkir tells come to mind, and he's this 12th century. Syrian gentleman and warrior in Christian translation who writes down his memoirs at the age of 90. And there's five stories there about encounters with Christians. And Apopo, he tells us, he has lots of encounters with Crusaders and the Franks. And he tells several stories of conversion and reversion going both ways. And I have the impression that there is no particular didactic message here. It's a kind of ajaib, the wonders of the world. And like we are amused, all of us here, you know, we hear their story and say, wow, that's interesting. I think some authors wanted the same effect, to achieve the same effect telling those stories. Not in martyrologies, but in other kinds of texts.
Yeah, but the fact that these stories are told, combined with the martyrologies, combined with the abjuration formula, combined with the legislation that shows up in Judaism, Christianity, and Islam concerning conversion and reversion, suggests something not marginal, I think.
No, I agree in this
context. Nadia?
Well, I only wanted to remark on Abd al-Masih that I see this story differently. I don't see it as a brigand who, undergoes redemption, but rather the depiction of an ideal Muslim warrior who is very good at all sorts of arms things. I mean, he's very good with his sword, he's very good with his spear and so on. So he's a perfect warrior in some ways. He could be a perfect warrior of Islam, but he rejects this and he prefers Christendom and he converts or he returns to Christianity. In fact, his name, Abd al-Masih, shows that he is of Christian origins, in any case, if that was his true name, I don't know. But anyway, I think the whole story portrays a different thing. It's not a story exactly of redemption, but a story of choice, of how this person really chooses the true faith despite the fact that he is very well adapted to being a Muslim world.
Yeah, I mean, this is certainly important that that we have here a strong hint to this Abd al-Masih becoming a jihad warrior, fighting, participating in the yearly raids into Byzantine lands. That's true. But the other point is that it's very, very implicitly stating that he is a Christian, an Arab Christian from Najran, from this and that tribe. And that's important for the audience, because these are the monks of Sinai, the Arab monks, and there are a lot of other monks, Greeks, Jordan, whatever, Syriac. And this is the first Arab hegumenos. So,
I understood that, but he's not depicted as somebody who did evil and then he returned to the good, which is also a topos in Christian stories and also in archaeology.
He's mentioned as plundering and burning, and he engaged in everything forbidden.
But that's what you're doing, as I fear.
It doesn't matter. He's doing.
Any relation to the Maltese of Najran?
No, not that I know.
Okay, we still have 5 minutes or a bit more.
I think it's worth maybe drawing attention quickly to a couple of things that are very interesting and somewhat idiosyncratic texts. We learn that one can do without converting, whereas often we're led to think that one has to convert to do these things. One is to become a mawla, to become a client. In the second text, it's clear that Ilyas's master, the carpenter, is a mawla for a couple of years before he converts. And it's well known that there can be mawali who are not Muslims, but it's not very well known, so it's nice to be reminded of that here. The other thing in the story of Abd al-Masih, if we take it, and this stands here, it's a literary text because we're talking about what's plausible. And it strikes me that it's not actually that he has to convert in order to even begin to think about going and raiding. He just goes and raids on the Byzantine frontier, and en passant, he decides that, I'll start praying with these guys also. But we have the possibility of an Arab Christian kind of getting sucked into this, maybe without converting up front. And that's very interesting, and I think reflects a social reality. And the other thing that's worth noting, I think, is it gestures to the political importance of conversion in certain cases. Because when down below he tells his own story, he says, "I once was of the adherents of this gospel, but today I am of its enemies." Yes, that means he's a Muslim, but I think in the context of this text, it also means that he fights the Romans. And for this Melkite Greek text, I mean, it's not a good thing to fight the Romans. And this actually, I mean, of course, we talked about suspicion of converts, and we'll talk about it more, suspicions of disloyalty, especially loyalty to Christian enemies. And there are hints of a reality to that suspicion here, I think.
I mean, that's maybe an interesting remark, because in the context of what I have said, that the Melkite Church, and that is mainly the opinion of Sidney Griffiths, is in the 8th, 9th century, I mean, it's more or less an independent church, but actually this text is very pro-Byzantium, no? So you should not fight Byzantium, and Byzantium, that's, so to speak, our homeland. Yeah, that's true, that's interesting.
That's it? Okay. So thank you very much.